In this video, we talk about the Arithmetic and Logic Unit. The ALU we talk about is a combinational circuit which is part of the Central Processing Unit, or CPU for short, that carries out arithmetic and logic operations. We are going to analyze a very simple 8-bit ALU, which is perfect to understand this component. This particular ALU is taken from the book But How Do It Know? From J. Clark Scott, which is a perfect guide to understand computers. So, with John's permission, we can start the analysis. Typically, the ALU has direct input and output access to the processor controller and the main memory. In the Scott CPU as well, we can see the ALU is connected to the RAM through the bus and it is connected to the control section through some wires. We have already seen this architecture in previous video, but let's remember a few things. The ALU has as inputs the op lines, the carry in, and the A and B inputs coming from the bus. It has as output the C output connected to the bus through the ACC register, the carry out a larger equal and zero, which we'll see later. The fundamental purpose of the ALU is executing the arithmetic and logic operations required from the instruction decoded from the control section. The control section communicates the required operation to the ALU through the op lines. In this video, we are going to focus on the ALU, and the ALU we are going to build is composed by 7 elements, which we have already seen in previous videos, but we are going to put them all together, designing a way to select the different elements. We have 3 components for the arithmetic operations in order to execute calculation: right and left shifter, and the adder. We have 4 components for the logic part, plus some information bits in order to manipulate bits. One of the most important ALU component is the adder we analyzed in previous video. Here you can see a full adder which adds 2 bits and gives a bit as a result plus a carry out. With 8 full adders as this one, we built a 8-bit adder like this. You can see in this simulation 0 plus 0 is equal 0. And in this other simulation, 3 plus 4 is equal 7. You can see the carry in and the carry out. And remember, the adder is important not only for the addition, but for all the 4 operations, as we saw in previous video. Here, you can see the left shifter. It is done using 2 register and leaving set and enable inputs to 1. In this way, we have the output immediately after the arrival of the inputs. The byte 00000010 is left shifted in 00000100. Note that the starting byte corresponds to the decimal number 2, and the shifted 1 to the number 4. So left shifting of 1 position is like multiplying by 2, shifting of 2 position is like multiplying by 4, and so on. So shifter is important in multiplication. Note that we also have the carry here. Here you can see the right shifter. The byte 11111100 is right shifted in 01111100. Note that the starting byte corresponds to the decimal number 248 and the shifted one to the number 124. So right shifting of 1 position is like dividing by 2, and shifting of 2 positions is like dividing by 4, and so on. So shifter is important in divisions. Note that we also have the carry here. The main purpose of the logic unit is manipulating bits. We have the AND gate, which puts in AND 2 bytes, but bit by bit. So, I have to compare the least important bit of a byte with the least important bit of the other byte, and so on. This way of comparing bits by bit is called bitwise, and we are doing bitwise operations. The NOT gate inverts the input byte, and the bitwise OR gate puts the 2 bytes in OR, always bit by bit. All these gates are important in order to manage bits. For example, the NOT gates can be useful in the subtraction to invert all the bits of the subtrahend in order to calculate the second complement. An important gate is the XOR gate. It can be used, for example, to check if two bytes are equal. Only in this case all the outputs are at zero. For example, we can check if byte A is equal to byte B by passing the two bytes through the XOR gate. Since this is a bitwise XOR, I compare bit by bit the least significant bit of byte A with the least significant bit of byte B. If the two bytes are equal, the result is a zero byte. A XOR can be helpful in other way too. Let's see this circuit. We have to imagine this as a way to compare two bytes, but bit by bit, starting from the most significant one to finish with the least significant one. First note, output C is simply XOR of A and B. When A and B are equal, for example 1-1, the output still equal of the AND gate 3, having an input to 1, depends on the input equal, so depend on the previous equal check. If previous check is equal, the bit is 1, so still equal is on. If previous check is not equal, the bit is 0, and still equal propagates this 0. Because we need just a different bit to have a different byte. Now, let's see the A larger part. In the A equal B case, output C is 0 and the AND with 3 inputs, AND 4, is blocked. So, still A larger output depends on A larger input, so from the previous check. Note that if the previous check is at 1, A is larger than B, and the 1 is propagated on the bottom, because if a most significant bit is larger, then the whole byte is larger. In the case of A and B different, C is at 1, and if the more significant bits on the top are equal, we have the equal signal at 1. So, the output of AND 4 depends on A input. In this case, A input is 1, so we have a 1 on the output of the OR to signal that A is larger than B. You can see if A was 0 and B 1, the OR would be at 0, signaling that A is not larger than B, but it is not even equal, so B is larger than A, if we get a 0 in equal line and in A larger line. Putting the previous circuit one under the other 8 times, starting from the most significant bit and finishing with the least significant one, we have a 2-byte comparator. The output C is the XOR output, and equal and A larger come from the comparator we have just described. The symbol is this. Now you see how ALU makes comparison, and now you can understand better the statement if A equal B then, where to check if A is equal B, we have just to ask to the ALU a comparison operation, putting A and B as operands and checking the equal line. All the results of the operations are collected by the output bus C, and if we connect to the output bus a OR gate with 8 inputs and we add a NOT gate at the end, we get a line which is 1 only when the bus contains the byte 0. We call this a 0 block, and this is the symbol. So now we put together all our logic and arithmetic components to build the ALU. We see input A and input B. We see that input A goes in the one input components. we see output C and some information bit as equal, A larger, 0 and the carry out. Actually, we can put together the carry with the shift in or the shift out because they are used in a very similar way. Important inputs of the ALU are the op lines. Having 7 components, this ALU needs just a 3-to-8 decoder, so we have 3 operation lines. You see the combination 000 opens the enabler of the adder, letting the adder output pass. 001 lets the right shifter output pass, and so on. Being this a combinational circuit, every component reacts to the inputs and puts the result on the output. We get only one output at a time by acting on the op lines, which for every combination activates one and only one line of the decoder, and so one and only one enabler. The last combination, the 111, is not connected, and we use it for selecting the comparison operation, which actually is always working, so we get the comparison in every operations. But the 111 case is okay when we need just the comparison and not other operation. This is the ALU coding table. There is another function we need, and is called bus1. It is a combinational circuit which put a 1 on the bus. You can see if bus1 is at 1, all the AND are blocked and the output is at 0, but the OR output is at 1. On the contrary, if we put a 0 on the bus1, the data pass through the circuit unchanged. We'll see in the next video how useful this can be when we have to increment the instruction address register. In order to simulate the ALU behavior, we need some register and bus1. We need register TMP because by storing B operand, we can put on the bus A operand. We need the accumulator register to store momentarily the result of the operations, and we need at least 2 registers to provide operands to the ALU. So, with this configuration, we are going to simulate the add operation. For example, we imagine having the number 4 in R0 and the number 3 in R1. We want to add R0 to R1 and put the result in R1. So first we put the right code in op lines. Secondly, we move the R1 byte in TMP. Third, we put R0 in A input. Immediately we have the result on output C. Remember, the ALU is a combinational circuit. And we give a set pulse to store it in the accumulator register. Finally, we store the number 7 in register R1. So here you are with our simulation. We can see our 8-bit ALU, and here there is the bus1 and the TMP register. As output, I have the accumulator register. And here we have R0 and R1. So I already put inside these 2 registers the right number, but we can check it. R0 should have the number 4. We can see here, reading on the bus, there is the number 4, because the least significant bit is C0. So this is the number 4 inside the R0 register. Inside the R1 register, we have the number 3. So I'm going to add the content of these 2 registers. So first we put the number 3 inside the R1 register on the bus, enabling the R1 register. Secondly, I have to acquire it from TMP register, giving a set pulse. And this is enough. So now I free the bus. And my number 3 is inside TMP. So now I put the number 4, the R0 content, on the bus, clicking enable. So is here, And here we have already the number 7, so at the output of the ALU, because the ALU is a combinational circuit. We can see the op line are at 0. It was already at 0. So this is the add operation. So on the output of the ALU, there is already the result. But we have to acquire this result inside the accumulator register. So we click S, set, and now is inside this the accumulator register. Now we can free the bus, and now with our result inside the accumulator, we have to store the result on the R1 register. So we put on the bus the accumulator content, and we acquire, giving a set pulse. Okay, now we free the bus, and now we should have our result, the number 7, inside R1 register. We can put on the bus the content of R1 and going to read the content of the bus, and is 0000011, that is the number 7 on binary. Please leave me a comment and let me know if you liked this video. Make sure you put a thumb up, click the notification bell, and subscribe to my channel.